oversight. 6, personal data and credit. 7, prison reform. 8, judicial reform. 9, police reform act. 10, FCC licensing of public airways. 11, Confederate monuments and institutions. 12, AJP program for education and jobs. 13, black responsibility. So you've got this list and we get it. But in this moment of reckoning on every level, because we are communities still with the highest numbers of negatives in almost every category, do you think that we need to also put a charge to Donald Trump? Because, and hear me on this, I'm thinking about when Barack Obama was president. And I'm remembering two people specifically, and people may hate me for this, but it's the truth. And one of them's a friend of mine, Tavis Smiley and Cornel West. They went after Barack Hussein Obama. But when Donald John Trump came to office, their silence was deafening. Is this another one of those moments where we're holding the Democrats accountable and not this man who doesn't care? He has blood on his hands. He doesn't care about opening an economy when it affects people that look like us more so than any other community. He doesn't care that we're not getting PPPs, the loans from the banks. We're not able to access them like other communities, you know, our housing, you know. What about him? What about holding the, putting him accountable, holding him accountable, putting him in front of you and saying, look, President Trump, because we don't know if he will win or if he will lose. We just don't know. So it's not just one party, but it should be two, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, that's why we should present this to both sides and see who's going to really be the one who help us out in a major way. I don't think you should fall in love with any president because at the end of the day, you know, most of them are just politicians. You know, you don't have any civil rights leaders, you have politicians, and they do what politicians do. You know, so, you know, that being said, you know, most Black people want to vote for Biden, for what I understand. So that's fine. You know, I'm not putting any pressure on anybody to vote for anybody they don't want to vote for. What I say, you put pressure on the candidate that really wants your vote. I don't think, you know, Trump could care less really about our vote. He may want it, but who knows? He's not reaching out to get it. And Biden is. So, you know, since he is reaching out, you don't get it for free. You gotta give up something. You know, he want us to show up. He want us to get out there and do it.
He wants Donald Trump wants us to show up in the midst of death. He doesn't want us to do
it. In the midst of what?
He's playing with our postal service.
Yeah.
That deserves an outcry, doesn't it?
I mean, yeah, it does deserve an outcry. And it's the reason why, you know, Joe Biden should really do the right thing by Black people in America and help us in a major way. And become the president of the United States. It's a simple thing to do. It's to help us out in a major way and not in a minor way. That's all we're asking. And he can, you know, he will show up in droves.
So, yeah. And what I get from you, this contract with Black America is because you see the hurt, how great the hurt is. And that's what I'm getting. And the fact that this is a transformational moment and you want to push the envelope to get them to do more than what has been done because we're still hurting. Am I correct in hearing that?
Yeah, now's the time to do a deal. You don't do a deal after the presidency. You do a deal before, like every other group. So this is what we want to do. And to get, I mean, I don't understand why us asking for something is so controversial.
I agree with you there.
And not just saying, thank you for what you're giving us. You know, they put out a plan. We're supposed to be like, thank you very much. And just wait for them to do that. Or do we say, well, these are some of the things we want. These are some of the things that could help our communities in a major way. And you have to consider them. And if you really want our vote, do them. If you really want us to show up and show out, do it.
So since we've been talking, I've been getting various text messages from various people, to include someone in the Biden campaign. And they told me that they are willing to chat with you. Would you accept their invitation?
I mean, I would like to talk to one of the candidates. I don't really want to talk to somebody in the campaign.
I hear you. Would you talk with Vice President Biden if he... Okay.
Of course.
Okay.
Of course. Vice President Biden, Senator Harris. Why not?
So at the end of the day, I've talked to several organizations that are looking at your plan. They say it's a great plan. But the question is, if they join on with you, will you speak in one voice? Because many people, it's not an option about voting. They say, yeah, you know, even if, and these are these backdoor conversations. They say, even if, you know, they become president, which they are hopeful, president and vice president, you still hold them accountable. You get them in and then hold them accountable. And for those of you in the hood, you kick their butts to hold them accountable, even though, you know, that's the bottom line. Get them in.
Yeah, I mean, this is a 4-year, 8-year, 10-year fight to get everything we supposed to get. So nobody's thinking this is a magic bullet. You know, this is something that we gotta first get them to sign on to. Of course, we could talk in one voice. But I actually voice want people's voting. Help to make the
that
contract.
One voice is voting. Hold you on. Got make the, you got to say yeah. vote.
That part will happen, you know, once the candidates, to me, step up to the plate.
So let's go down the contract of America. What is stepping, listening to what Biden has from that piece of paper, and again, I am not espousing any candidate. I'm just giving you point by point, because if we, as a journalist, if you say that they're not doing, I have to show you what they're saying they're going to do. And at the same time, I have to show that you're...
Yeah, some of the things overlap, without a doubt. You know, but I just think that more can be done in more areas to help us really, you know, push other industries and other things that the government has influence on to be more inclusive. And the time to ask and beg and plead is over. It's time for the government to step in, just like they were involved in our systematic downturn. They should be involved in our systematic upturn. And that's just the way it should be. I don't see how us sitting back and accepting their plan without having anything to demand, I don't know how that gets them the vote, or how they can see that that gets them the vote. You know, every organization, group goes with plans and demands, and I don't understand why we have to be different.
Are you going to vote?
Yeah, I hope so. I want to.
God willing, you will, right?
God willing,
as
I will.
As the folks in the South, God willing and the creek don't rise, you will, right?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, you know, I think we got God on our side. With
Have
this.
You voted before?
Yeah. I vote all the time.
All right. Are you kind of along that, because it sounds like, I mean, I had a chance to privately talk with Colin Kaepernick, and he was talking about the issues. If the issues don't fit, you know, because people are saying, oh, he was saying don't vote. And I asked him, and he said, no, it's about the issue. Is that where you are? But it kind of goes, if the candidate doesn't have the issue, you're not going to vote for them. But are you going to vote for the other candidate? Because if you don't vote for the Democrats, you're basically voting for Donald Trump in this election. And that's what you don't want.
No, I mean, if you don't vote, you just don't vote. You're not voting for
anybody.
No,
that's not true. I'm going to disagree with you there. No,
it is true. It's not. It is true.
Well, let me
yes,
say
it
this.
Is.
Let me say this.
If you don't vote, you're not voting for anybody. Somebody can't pressure you to vote for a candidate that's not giving
Donald
you anything.
Donald Trump is looking
or
for
not
a
giving
low
you what
turnout.
You what
you
want.
Don't vote.
I'm pretty sure he is. I'm pretty sure he is. No, no, I'm not. No, I'm not. Joe Biden can earn my vote today.
Just this is unscientific, but I want to see all of you who just heard this. Do you believe that if you don't vote, it doesn't matter? I want to see what people are saying. I want to see. I don't want to see the heart.
I'm not saying it don't matter.
Well, it doesn't matter.
I'm saying if you don't vote, that's not a vote for the other guy.
If you
don't
vote,
that's not how it works.
I want you guys to tell me.
If you don't vote, you should just be quiet and step back out of the system. Not worry about it. If you don't vote, you shouldn't have anything to say. But to me, I'm an advocate of voting. I would love to vote for the candidates that everybody want to roll with. But I want to make sure they roll with us too. You know, I don't want it to be taken for granted. You know, that to me is, to me, just giving away the vote. And they have no obligation to do anything.
So I'm going to say this. I'm from Baltimore, grew up here, lived here majority of my life. And I've gotten to know a lot of politics around here. I started my journalism career here in Baltimore. And my first program director in radio was a man by the name of Kwaisi Mfume. Many of you know his name. You would have never known his name. He is now Congressman Kwaisi Mfume. You would have never known his name if he had not won the city council race in Baltimore. He won by 3 votes. If 3 people sat down, or 4 people said he wouldn't have had. He would. So I believe each vote matters. So give me.
Yeah, each vote. I'm not saying that each vote don't matter. That's not what I'm saying. I'm actually saying.
I know you're saying it, but
I know every vote. I know every vote matter. I know every vote matter, and they do too. So do the right thing, and we'll be out there. Boy, I'll scream to the top of the rafters for everybody.
Somebody told me to set up the call for Ice Cube and Biden. I can't even set up my own interview with Biden and Kamala Harris, so don't even try that. But we're working on that. But no, but people are listening to you tonight because you are a voice. You are a voice, and people want to know. And I want to go to something. I want to go back in time, and I'm going to play this. And we're going to talk about this. Right about now, wake up, you ain't caught in full effect. Judge Gray decided. In the case of NWA versus the police department, the prosecuting attorneys are MC Reigns, Ice Cube, and Easy in Oklahoma E. The clean version. Ice Cube, take the stand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the
clean version? What you playing it for? Man, you gotta play the hardcore version.
Prolific. You were ahead of your time. And this has been 401 years of Black people dealing with policing. What do we see? What do we see? Yeah. What is that viral video that we're seeing that man shot inside his car?
Yeah.
What if the bullets ricocheted off and hit those 3 children? What if the shrapnel from the bullet hit the 3 children?
I mean, they don't care. I mean, obviously they don't care. You know, our life is looked at as valuable. That's why people got to run around yelling Black Lives Matter. And it's a shame. It's the reason why we have to push. And, you know, we can't be satisfied with, you know, who we think is a friendly face, we got to push them to do the right thing. Because, you know, every party got their own tricks to keep us at the bottom of this pyramid, and it's time for us.
So this is a moment of racial reckoning. There was a call because of minorities, because Black people still being a community with the highest numbers of negatives in almost every category, and this racial reckoning with Black Lives Matter. And you talked about the yellow police tape. DC Mayor Muriel Bowser painted Black Lives Matter Square or Boulevard or area, I forgot the end of the name, but painted that with that color, the yellow police tape color, the caution tape. Mm-hmm. In front of the White House, one of the most expensive properties in this nation. There is a reckoning. There's a transformational moment. Kamala Harris was brought on this presidential ticket because of an acknowledgement of this moment in history. What do you want as it relates to the issue of policing? You've been singing about it since the 80s, and we're still in it. And we've been in it for 401 years. What do you want when it comes to issues of policing and police reform?
I mean, police justice, prison reform, you know, across the board. You know, it's first of all, we got to get the bad guys out. You know,
weed bad policing, weed out the bad police. That's what you're saying.
Weed out the bad police. And if you get the bad ones out or you hold them accountable, you wouldn't even have to defund them. You know what I mean? It's like, we want less because we'll have less coming into our communities treating us, you know, like suspects and not like victims sometimes. So, you know, it's a thing where first we want accountability. We want to know who all the bad apples are. We believe the FBI has a database and they know who all the skinheads and Nazis and KKK, Confederate loving sympathizers are, you know, all these nicknames they got for each other. They know who everybody is and get them off the force. That's what we want. We want better DAs, you know. It's just the whole system is terrible. The prison system is just built on free labor. It's just slavery, you know, in another name. So we want to change all that. We got to get rid of all that because we're the ones designated to be in
there. That's right.
We're the ones designated to
and
be the
labor. Right. And they don't realize
they railroad us and funnel us into these systems, and we can never get out sometimes. So it's just it's a mess that needs a mop, and it's time to clean
like
it up.
It's a mess that needs a mop, and it's time to clean it up. You got a new song coming out.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously. Okay, number seven, prison reform. And we talked about this. This prisons are a business. Private prisons are a business. And their business is to house us to make money.
Exactly. You know, prison, first of all, workers should get minimum wage in prison. And second of all, you shouldn't have to work if you don't want to. You're there to serve your time. So all these games they plan to reinvent slavery got to go out the window.
So you
get rid of
You said private run prisons will be abolished, prison labor disallowed without consent, and nonviolent offenders incarcerated for 10 years or longer will be freed if good behavior standards met. All prisoners for marijuana possession freed. First offense for illegal drug use or possession to require government payment for entry into an approved drug rehabilitation program rather than imprisonment. Once any prisoner completes sentences, voting rights are restored.
Why not? I mean, you know, some of these, of course, I'm pretty sure we have pushback on, but we got to talk about them. I believe, you know, everybody know the system is unfair. So how do you shore it up? How do you make it fair? And so, you know, that's a start. But, you know, like I said, nobody goes into a negotiation thinking you're going to get 100% of what you're asking for. So we don't expect that either, but some of these to me are fixes that have to be made Or, you know, it's like, we'll see you at the next riot. Mm.
So I'm going to tell you something. While we're sitting here talking, people are just tweeting up the storm. They're quoting you. And it's good because we need to hear what's going on, because there's a lot of confusion and we needed to hear this to decipher all of this, because the Black community is so fractured. We need to come together and understand what each other is saying so we can figure this out, so we can move to all can move to the mountaintop and see the promised land together.
Yeah.
Let's go to number eight, judicial reforms. Eliminate mandatory minimums and three strike laws. The Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice reform through stricter guidelines and greater oversight over police departments. DOJ can be sued for noncompliance. Lynching to become a federal hate crime, and the KKK, or the Ku Klux Klan, declared a terrorist organization. That last part, I'm with you. And you know, right now, the Department of Justice under the Trump administration has diminished, basically almost abolished, well, pretty much abolished the Civil Rights Division that dealt with all of the cases. A lot of the civil rights cases, they were trying to deal with the backlog, and now this division is gone and they're not dealing with anything. So you deal with that. So, okay. So I believe in a Biden Justice Department, I believe they would bring that back. That's just what the Democrats do. We don't have.
But they got to do more. They got to do a little more than just bring back a program that still ended up with the numbers that we're dealing with. You know, it's over 2.5 million people in prison. So, you know, that's not the way to go.
I agree. And this is me as a Black woman. This is not me as a journalist, but me as a Black woman says, I agree with naming the KKK a terrorist organization. But there is a plan. There is a plan now underway under the George Floyd Act to name lynching is a federal hate crime. So that is underway. And all of these years, we have never had a federal hate crime for lynching. Fannie Lou Hamer said, we're sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I mean, we've been dealing with this for 401 years, and we still do not have a federal law against hate crimes. And they're trying to expand it. It's not just about strange fruit hanging from a tree or like the dragging death of James Byrd. They're expanding the definition of lynching. So it's not like what happened to George Floyd. They're considering that a lynching now. All right. Police Reform Act. Police reforms, that's number nine of the contract with Black America. Number nine, Police Reform Act. Police reforms will be implemented in an expansive act that will at minimum include elimination of qualified immunity, requirement of mandatory malpractice insurance for police officers, make municipalities liable for unconstitutional actions by police, mandatory use of dashboard and body cams, elimination of chokeholds and no-knock warrants, establishment of residency requirements, the de-escalation training, and requirement to update training, severe penalties for evidence tampering, including withholding DNA, a federal database of police and disciplinary records established and made public, and once fired for cause, cannot be rehired. Creation of Office of Independent Prosecutors to solely focus on prosecuting police accused of wrongdoing. Other reforms as listed in greater detail in the contract with Black America. So, but they're asking for body cams. Dems are asking for body cams. They're the ones pushing to stop the chokeholds. The Republicans are having a problem with that. And they're also Democrats are also putting the no-knock warrants in. A lot of this is already here, but you want more.
But we got to get qualified immunity out of there. You know, that's a license to kill. We really need police to have malpractice insurance. You know, why should a citizen pay taxes for his police department, then his police department come and abuse him or another citizen, and then the public has to pay the lawsuit? It doesn't make sense. You know, police should be like, you know, doctors or anybody else with malpractice insurance. So if they have too many write-ups, they'll become a liability and they'll get kicked off the force that way. So to me, it's a way to untie the hands of the chief and the DAs and these people to get them a little off the hook make it a money thing, where a officer behaving like the guy that killed George Floyd, you know, with 17 write-ups or whatever, would have cost the department too much money. They would have fired him, you know, a long time ago, years ago, because he would have ended up costing them money. So, you know, these are some of the things that they can actually do to help make cops who think they have, you know, total carte blanche to hurt us with, you know, immunity. This will make them think twice.
So, you know, I look at what you're talking about. Let me see, going back to police reform, the Police Reform Act, number 9. If you don't know what this is, guys, you can Google this. The Contract with Black America. You can Google this and you can find it. Ice Cube, tell them where to find it, because I want them to look with us so they can see this, so they can see what you're actually talking about.
You can go to CWBA.world. CWBA, Contract with Black America, CWBA.world.
So you talk about no-knock warrants, Breonna Taylor. You talk about evidence tampering, Walter Scott in South Carolina. Yes. Remember that? We saw that video. You're dealing with real issues. These are not crazy issues. But my question is, what made you decide to do this now versus a couple of years ago? What made you decide now?
Well, a couple of years ago, I had wrote up something that's in our plan called the Americans Job Pact, which I thought was a great way to get industry, the community, and government to work together where it wouldn't cost any of them any extra money. It would actually do everything to help all three facets. So we wrote that up, and it kind of laid dormant. I actually ended up, you know, starting a basketball league, the Big Three.
I heard about that.
And yeah, so I ended up, you know,
retired, right?
Yeah. We started off with, you know, retired NBA players, giving them a way to, you know, get back out there, and the league was growing. So I couldn't step away. You know, if you invent something like that, you really have to put, you know, 24/7, 365 days into it for it to really grow. So I had spent years growing that. And when the George Floyd incident happened, I felt like, you know, it was a lot of, you know, anger in the streets, a lot of protesting. But I wanted to make sure that at the end of the day, there was a plan that everybody could get behind or add on to, you know, and we still want people to add on their ideas on how to make this better. That dealt with the problem across the board, not just police reform, but like you said, we're dealing with financial reform. You know, there's things I think that's missing in there when it comes to healthcare and Black women's issues that we need help on to make sure that we're tackling everything across the board. And we wanted to have something so when, for this moment right here, for when, you know, it's time for a candidate to ask for your vote, that you have something in your hand that they could get behind. You know, demands, things you're asking for from them. They're asking for your vote, and you should get something for that. So, of course, you know, we've been spending our time getting it up to a level where we can be at this moment where the candidates, you know, have to take us serious.
So I think about the first Black woman to run for president in 1972, the late, great Shirley Chisholm, before there was Kamala, before there was Carol Moseley Braun and any other Black woman, there was Shirley Chisholm. And she said, if you don't have a seat at the table, bring a folding chair. Joe Biden's team is trying to get you to the table. And I don't think you're going to have a folding chair. When you get there and you own the table, what are you going to say? Because they're offering you this right now. Because they're texting me saying, let them know that we are willing to meet with him. once you get to that table, because it's going to happen, and I would like for you to call me from there and let me know what was said so I can report it, you know. But once you get there, Q, what are you going to say? What are you going to do?
Well, I mean, they have the plan. The question is what they're going to say to me. I mean, what part of this that they agree with, that they support, what part of this that they don't support or can't do, and we'll discuss why. So, you know, to me, it's laid out what I'm asking for. I'm not asking for anything other than what's laid out there, unless we add more to the plan. You know, I'm not going to ask for anything personal for myself. So everything is going to have to deal with the plan.
What makes you lay awake at night?
Just thinking about, you know, my kids and their kids and their kids and their kids having to deal with the same thing I had to deal with growing up. And so that's what keeps me up is, you know, we got to fix this now. It's our turn. It's nobody else's turn. So, you know, I mean, we could be grown teenagers walking around here, or we can be grown men and women. And so that's what it's time for us to stand up for our people at the right time and try to get some true equality and true advancement in this country.
So sitting in this unique perch that I've been blessed to sit in for 23 years, covering the White House for American Urban Radio Networks, I've noticed the squeaky wheel gets the oil, and you're squeaking loudly. So it seems like you may get the oil, but the big question, the piece that is the fly in the ointment, if you will, is the vote. Is the vote. People want to know that they can be in lock, that you will be in lockstep with them. Hold them accountable, but vote.
Well, let's talk about it. I would love to be a cheerleader and vote for the candidates that's down to do what's in this plan. I would love to go out there and push the people. But we got to talk and see if they into this, because I think we need it. It's not like I'm asking for anything for us that is not needed or unnecessary. And I think I'm making their job easy. I'm not a legislator, you know what I mean? But we put together something that's pretty good that could help the people for real. And they would, you know, and, you know, I want them to be heroes. So for that to happen, they have to step up and actually be heroes.
So I don't want to make this lopsided. I got to bring Donald John Trump into it, the 45th president of the United States of America. He's having his coronation for a second time this week.
Yeah.
He likes rappers, as you see. If he brought you into the White House, into this COVID-laden White House, what would you say to him? Because if he wanted to hear what you had to say to possibly try to gain the black vote, because you know they out there trying to win it and trying to whatever with it.
I think, you know, we would be crazy not to listen to him. It wouldn't make any sense not to.
So what would you say to Donald John Trump if he invited you to? So you're open to meet with him as well, okay. So what would you say to him? You would listen to him, but what would you say? Because he wants to hear, if he invites you in, he wants to hear what you have to say.
I would tell him the same thing. Read the plan, man. I mean, I don't have to go in there doing a lot of talking. I mean, how much talking do I have to really do? Read the plan. Tell me what you can do, what you can't do, what you don't want to do, and let's talk about it. That's
so
it.
You know he doesn't read. He doesn't read.
Well, if he don't read, he asked out. Somebody got to read. Somebody got to read.
Maybe Jared. All right. Well,
I'll meet with Jared. It don't matter. Somebody got to read. Whoever read, I'll meet.
You know, I am so honored that you wanted to talk to me, and I appreciate you. And everyone has a story, and I listen to people's story, and it's not about me agreeing or not. The only thing I say as a Black woman is that I say vote, 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 vote. As I'm quoting Beyonce, mm-hmm. make your life dependent on it. But at the end of the day, I appreciate you. And I got to ask you a question. Well, I want to let you close out. But before that, my brother wanted me to ask you a question. My brother, Robert, from Baltimore, he's mm-hmm. a Fridays fan. He wants to know, are you guys mm-hmm. going to do a reunion? You guys, you know, because of John Witherspoon or something.
If we had Black studios, we'd have it Tyler done like Perry, that. But Tyler since Perry we don't. Well, that's a great thing. But I'm saying this, the movie is owned by Warner Brothers. So we have to, you know, like I said, I'd be able to grab it from them and do it. But they don't want to do that. So we got an issue here.
Well, I appreciate you. And I'm going to let you close out. It's we got a few minutes, two more minutes left. And I want you to talk to America, help them understand all this controversy. I think we have helped people understand, especially Black Twitter, understand where you're coming from. But help them understand, give in your words, give them your heart about the community that you're fighting for.
Well, I'm fighting for the Black community. We've needed a lot of things across the board done to help us get out to city.